Tabernacle Man.
Teaching biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.
Since 1985, Dr. Terry Harman has taught both Jewish and Christian audiences the significance of the tabernacle and the garments of the high priest. He combines his interests with traditional Jewish and Christian interpretations of the Bible, as well as his passion for the scriptures, multimedia, costumes, and drama to deliver a down-to-earth application of biblical texts. His teachings explore the historical backgrounds as well as the symbolism behind each piece of furniture associated with the Tabernacle of Moses. The biblical stories will come alive before your very eyes as he offers biblical principles to a sight and sound generation. Get a pencil and paper ready. You do not want to miss the fresh insights of today's lesson.
The five Levitical sacrifices that are discussed in Leviticus, as we've discussed before, are misunderstood by Jews and Christians. Jews, for the most part today, would say that the sacrificial system no longer exists because the Romans destroyed the Second Temple in 70 CE. I use the word CE for common era of the Christians and Jews. In traditional Jewish understanding, the reading and studying of these portions, especially on Yom Kippur, is just as meaningful. It's almost a substitute for actually offering the sacrifices at the temple. So reading them, there is a value. More liberal or modern Jewish thinkers would suggest that after the destruction of the temple in 70 CE, prayer or the sacrifice of the heart became the new sacrifice or the new way to draw closer to God or seek forgiveness for the sins against God. Christians, however, look at this section in the sacrificial system totally different. Christians would say that Jesus' death on the cross and literal resurrection from the grave fulfilled or became a substitute for the animal offerings of old. They would say that the believer, as long as they go directly to Jesus, they can have forgiveness of sins and believe that the old sacrificial system is null and void today. However, as we said in the beginning, both groups read these scriptures on a regular basis. For Jews, the Torah readings are on a three-year cycle. For many Christians, they have some type of daily devotional system of working their way through the scriptures. So both read and both study this portion of scripture. So if it's null and void for the Christians, and Jesus replaced the sacrificial system, or if in some Jewish thinking this will be reinstituted when there's a third temple one day in Jerusalem, if both these groups are looking at it differently, but both groups still read it, are there some principles, are there some key concepts that we can look at today and apply these scriptures in our life for a system that is not relevant in many ways today without a temple? And I would say that there is, that all of scripture, whether it appears out an outdated mode of worship or an outdated mode of thinking, all of scripture has some truths, has some principles, has some key concepts that if we scratch the surface deep enough, we can mine the nuggets out of the Bible and apply it to our life today. So I want to look at these five chapters in particular in the next couple of weeks and look at these chapters, these sacrifices, using the historical information, using some of the theological understanding, but applying it today. So we'll explore it by looking at what was the primary purpose of each sacrifice. There had to be a reason to bring this offering, this sacrifice, to the Mishkan, to the temple. People just didn't say, hey, let's take some stuff up to see if the priest needs anything. There was a reason, there was a motivation for this behavior. Second, we want to look at what human longing or felt need was being met by bringing the sacrifice to the Lord. And the third thing was, what was the person or the nation trying to accomplish by practicing this ritual? Now, just as a way of review for a little bit, remember that the word sacrifice in English really is a misfortune in many ways to the Hebrew word korban. And we learned in previous lessons that that word korban would be better translated as offering in English. The root word means to draw close to. It's speaking of a personal connection, a desire to become intimate with, a desire to understand. There's a heartfelt relationship there, a sense of intimacy, but drawing close to something. In this case, drawing close to God, elevating ourselves spiritually in our understanding of God, in that relationship with God, making a closer connection. So to help the ancients draw closer, this sacrificial system was developed, permitted by God. Now you have to remember, at this time, the Hebrews had been in slave for over 400 years in Egypt. And so they've left Egypt. The Red Sea is split. And they're at the foot of Mount Sinai. Later, they're building the Mishkan or the tabernacle. And now they have to learn a new pattern, a new way of approaching God. Sacrifices, giving offerings to the gods, was not a new concept that the Hebrews came about. Many of the nations had some type of sacrificial system. However, as we'll see in our lessons, this sacrificial system devoted to the one true God was different than the others. And so there's more meaning for us to mine than looking at some of the other ancient religions. So when you wanted to draw closer to God, you came to the tabernacle, you came to the temple, the central place of worship, and you followed certain patterns to take care of certain human felt needs. Now, we know that the prophets also had times where they spoke to individuals and the nation about problems that had developed with the sacrificial system. And like us today, we forget the real meaning of many of the things we do. Whether we attend a synagogue or a church or some other type of study, house of worship, if we're not careful, the rituals that we do, the readings that we read, the activities that we become involved in, we'll forget the purpose of them, and they'll become meaningless if we're not careful. Yes, we'll remember, this is what my grandmother taught me, why we do this and why we don't do that. But if it doesn't take on a personal aspect, something that kind of gets in your heart, gets in your soul, then they can become dry and meaningless. And the prophets spoke about this because at times this sacrificial system became no more than empty rituals because their heart was not in it. Now let's look at Malachi chapter 1, verses 7 through 10. And I'm going to be reading from the Net Bible. You can find it on the internet, net.org. And I want you to listen to what the prophets said about the sacrificial system. You are offering improper sacrifices on my altar, yet you ask, how have I offended you? By treating the table of the Lord as if it was of no importance. They're speaking of the brazen altar, the altar of burnt sacrifice, as the table of the Lord. Table because they are bringing meat, they are bringing grain. You are offering improper sacrifices on my altar. Yet you ask, how have we offended you? By treating the table of the Lord as if it is of no importance. For when you offer blind animals as a sacrifice, is that not wrong? And when you offer the lame and the sick, it is not wrong as well? Indeed, try offering them to your governor. Will he be pleased with what you show or give you favor? Ask the Lord who rules over all. But now, plead for God's favor, that he might be gracious to us. With this kind of offering in your hands, how can he be pleased with you? Ask the Lord who rules over all. I wish that one of you would close the temple doors so that you no longer would light useless fires on my altar. I am not pleased with you, says the Lord who rules over all, and I will no longer accept an offering for you. See, the offerings were really just a tangible means, a way that the ancients and even us today in giving our offerings learn to approach God. We're humans, and so sometimes we need something we can see, that we can touch, that we can feel, that we can bring to our house of worship, or some activity that we're involved in outside our house of worship to help us draw closer to God. But the ancients got in trouble, and the prophets called them on it. They made the table of the Lord, they made the sacrificial system just empty rituals. Their heart wasn't involved. And God said, just keep your meat, keep your grain, keep your offerings. They don't mean anything because you're not doing it with the right intention. You see, it's not the size of the gift that matters. It's not actually what it is that we bring to the Lord as an offering as much as it is what is our intention in approaching the Lord. If our motivation isn't pure, if our motivation isn't right, we might as well just leave the gifts at home. He doesn't need them. God is not hungry. He doesn't need our meat. And might I say, in a modern context, God's not broke. He doesn't need your money. Our houses of worship need the money to continue the activities that we're doing, whether it's teaching or preaching or feeding the hungry, ministering to those that are the least, the last, the lost, and the lonely. Whatever activities we're doing, that's a human activity that we're doing for God, and He will bless it. But we don't need to treat God like He's a slot machine. And if I give you this much and pull the handle, all the sevens have to come up and you have to bless me. No, you and I are creatures and He's the creator. We don't tell God what to do. We're fortunate in that He chooses to use broken human beings to recreate, to make life better for all of us around. It just blows me away. So the sacrificial system, whether we look at the past or we look at our offerings today, our heart, the intent of our heart is what's most important. Even Samuel had to talk to the people. He said in 1 Samuel 15:22, does the Lord take pleasure in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as He does in obedience? Certainly, obedience is better than sacrifice. Paying attention is better than the fat of rams. So we don't want just meaningless rituals. So let's look at Leviticus chapter 1 and look at the burnt or whole offering. In Hebrew, this word for burnt or whole here is olah. And we need to remember this is one of the three voluntary acts of worship. This one was not mandatory. The whole or burnt offering, as we'll see, had a certain purpose, and it was enacted out to achieve a closeness to God in a specific way. So in Leviticus chapter 1, we're going to look at verses 1 through 17, and I'm going to be reading from a version that may be unfamiliar to some of you. It sounds like the King James Version, but it's the Jewish Publication Society of 1917. It's a public domain type of a document now, and so that's why I use it. And we're going to work through verse by verse, and I'll lift out a few things, some in review and some new information. So Leviticus chapter 1, starting at verse 1. And the Lord called unto Moses and spoke unto him out of the tent of meeting, saying. So let's look at some of these words. And the Lord called Moses. The word for Lord there is sometimes referred to as the four-letter name of God, YHWH in English transliteration. But this is a very sacred name. Traditional Jews today, when they would read this in the Torah, they would say Hashem, meaning the name. The name that's so sacred or so personal that they don't feel that they should utter it. Other Jews, when they would see this in the Torah, they would substitute the Hebrew word Adonai or the Lord, as we have here in English. And this is the word that the high priest would utter one time a year in the Holy of Holies on the Day of Atonement. So many say that the reason why we shouldn't try and verbalize it is we really have lost what the proper pronunciation is. It's used 83 times in Leviticus. Most of the time, it's used in connection when the offerer is bringing the offering to the table of the Lord. Only used half as much when it's talking about the Lord's connection with the priestly duties when it comes to the offering. So 83 times. It's used in connection with all of these five offerings. It's the name that communicates God's attributes of mercy and tenderness. And I think that's interesting. There are many names of God, but in Leviticus, the name that is most used is this one, the sacred one. So right there you see that intimate, that personal connection, that sacredness in this activity. And it says, and the Lord called unto Moses and spoke unto him out of the tent of meeting. Called unto Moses. Now, in Jewish understanding, the Bible portions are divided differently than the way Christians would. Both Christians and Jews have chapter headings and verse indications. But in Hebrew, usually within the first sentence, the most important word becomes the title or the name of that portion. And this one here is Vahikra, or called. And it's the title of the book, and it's the title of this portion. Remember, Leviticus is kind of like the minister's manual, the rabbi's manual for serving at the altar. So this isn't something that everybody would have necessarily been concerned about as far as performing everything exactly except the priest. That was his primary duty. But it's interesting that the way this is, and the Lord called to Moses. He didn't call to the nation of Israel. He's calling Moses right now in a personal way, using that most personal, intimate, sacred name. The Lord is talking with Moses. Now, he's not saying, hey, Moses, I got some new information to give you. He's calling him. He's pulling him toward him. It's only used three times in the Torah. Three times this word is used. And each time that it is used, God is going to reveal something new, something fresh to Moses to later impart to the people. He called Moses. Those three times are the burning bush, at Mount Sinai when he receives the revelation from God, and here in Leviticus chapter 1. Verse 2, "Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, when any man of you bringeth." Now, that word bringeth, this is the same root word as korban, to bring near. "When any man of you bringeth an offering," offering, there's korban, that word again, "unto the Lord," there's the sacred name again, "ye shall bring your offering of cattle, even of the herd, or of the flock." So ye shall bring your offering. This is voluntary, okay? This is not a mandated thing to take care of some specific sin. This is a voluntary act of worship. And it says the cattle, the herd, or the flock. So this is a domesticated animal. This is not a wild animal that someone has captured in the wilderness. This is something that they have provided food for. They've provided shelter. They've provided protection. You've invested your time, your talent, and your treasure in this animal. This animal represents where you'll get your milk from, possibly, where you'll get the leather for your garments. It may feed your family. So this is something that's very important in that type of society. We exchange money today. In that time, your wealth was not only measured by the size of your family, but the size of your flock and your herd. So it's something you're invested in. Verse 3, "If his offering be a burnt offering," there's the Hebrew word, olah, "a burnt offering of the herd, he shall offer it a male without blemish. He shall bring it to the door of the tent of meeting." All right, just a little review here. All right. The offerings have kind of a sliding scale as to what you can present before the Lord. The Lord recognized that not everybody is in the station, same station in life. Not everybody has the same amount of resources available to them. But everybody, from the richest to the poorest, was able to approach God in this new pattern that he was offering them. So you'll see in Leviticus chapter 1 that we're talking about three sets here. And we'll look at it as we go. But here he's talking about from the herd. So we're talking about some form of cattle. Now it says specifically it needs to be a male without blemish. Without blemish is the important part. It means to be pure. It needs to be not contaminated. You can't bring to the Lord an animal who is blind, or an animal who has a lame leg or has mange underneath its belly. This needs to be a whole, a complete, a healthy animal. Even today, when we are asked to contribute to our houses of worship, we shouldn't be dropping off things to the house of worship that we don't care about anymore, that mean nothing for us, that is just chump change, so to speak. It needs to be something that comes from the heart, that has some pull, some meaning to it. Various groups have different ways of maintaining that. That's not the point of our lesson. But the thing is if we're going to give to God, it should represent our best. It should represent our heart. "A male without blemish, and he shall bring it to the door of the tent of meeting." Now you can see in our representation of the model of the Mishkan on your screen that there was one primary entrance to the Mishkan, to the tabernacle. And that gate, or that first veil that was about 30 feet wide and about 7.5 feet high, was the main entrance. Before you went in there, you met a priest. Once you go in beyond that veil, you see the altar of burnt sacrifice. Now, we have the life-size one here that is behind me. And it's 7.5 foot by 7.5 foot square, 4.5 foot tall is the main part of the altar. and you can see that it's lifted up on two mounds, so wood could be put underneath there and the fires stoked continually. So this offering, whatever it was that you were bringing to the Lord, whether it would be an animal or a meal offering, as we'll see in the next chapter, that was inspected at the gate, at the first veil, by one of the Levitical priests. Now, why was it inspected? It was the priest's duty to make sure that what was being brought to the Lord was appropriate. We have to admit that sometimes we need a little bit of accountability and someone to kind of help us to stay true to our convictions. And in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Scriptures, the Torah, the priest provided that function. Now, they're bringing the offering to the door. Yes, they're looking at to see if the offering is appropriate, but you know who's really being inspected? The offerer. There's a key concept here. When it says to bring it to the door of the tent of meeting, who's the one that he may be accepted before the Lord? Who is the he that's being accepted before the Lord? The male animal? Yes, it's being inspected. But when it says, he shall bring it to the door of the tent of meeting that he may be accepted before the Lord, the one that needs the acceptance is the offerer. And so that offering, that inspection of the offering, is really just revealing the intention of that person's heart, the motivation of that person's heart. Yes, the priest would ask, what is this offering for? Why are you approaching the Lord this day? But that activity there, that accountability there, was to make sure the person's heart was doing this for the right reason. So accepted does not refer to the offering, but the offerer. See, we need to realize that acceptance was not automatic just because they brought a gift to the tabernacle. And I think there is something that believers today need to look at. If God doesn't need our money, and this activity is to help us to draw closer to God, then we shouldn't get hung up on the size of the gift. The size of the gift should represent what is welling up in our heart. There are many stories in the Bible where the gifts that were brought by a widow or someone that was poor in life brought such a small amount, but the Scripture reveals that gift was more important than the wealthy person bringing a large gift because their heart was in the right place when they gave it. So determining the intention is what prompted the inspection in the first place.
Many times over the years, Dr. Harman has been asked if his pictures of the high priest's garments and the tabernacle were available for the general public. We're pleased to announce that two new resources for ministers, rabbis, Sunday school teachers, and anyone waiting to make their Bible reading come alive are now available. The garments of the high priest contain the 8 golden garments of the high priest as well as the 4 white linen garments of all the other Levitical priests. The pattern of the tabernacle contains more than enough slides for the teacher who wants to deliver several stunning lessons on every part of the Tabernacle of Moses, including the altar of burnt sacrifice, the laver, the menorah, the table of showbread, the golden altar of incense, and the Ark of the Covenant. These two resources will capture the attention of your congregation, young and old alike.
Thank you for joining us today. This is the beginning of our series on the Tabernacle of Moses, and I hope that you're gaining some insight and gaining some spiritual nourishment from it. Often I'm asked, how can we help you, Terry? Well, let me be honest with you. Every program, every endeavor for God can use funds. But here's what I'd like to ask you to do. Instead of sending me some money, how about go to your temple, your house of worship, your synagogue, your church this week, and support the servants there. Support your rabbi, support your minister or your priest. Help them in their mission to bring God's word to that community. Help them to repair the pains and the hurts in your neighborhood. That would please me a lot. If you're not connected with a synagogue or a church, there's another way you can thank me for these messages. Find a soup kitchen. Find a homeless shelter. Find some people that need your help. You may say, I don't have much talent. I'm not very gifted. You'd be surprised what a kind word. You'd be surprised why by taking a ladle of warm soup on a cold day, what it can do to a person who's struggling. If you have a neighbor that's lost their job or laid off, think about buying a bag of groceries and just going over to them. How about finding an elderly person that feels lonely and thinks no one cares about them anymore, that the world's forgotten? How about dropping by and just speaking with them? Better yet, how about dropping by and taking them to the restaurant for a cup of coffee, a bowl of soup, and fellowship with them a little bit? There are nursing homes all over. Our world is broken and it needs a healing touch. And you can be that person. And that will thank me a lot.
Thank you so much for sharing this time with us. Truth of the matter is you could have been somewhere else watching something else, but instead you chose to be with us, and for that we are so grateful. Our goal here at Kohanim Ministry is to present biblical principles to a sight and sound generation.
If you are interested in Dr. Terry Harman speaking at your event, or you need more information about purchasing his multimedia resources for building your own lessons, feel free to contact him at 219-448-2673 or terry@thetabernacleman.com or thetabernacleman.com, or visit us on YouTube at The Tabernacle Man.